Live from Mercedes-Benz Melbourne at 135 Kingsway, South Melbourne. The Big House on 3AW 693.
The meek shall inherit the earth. The rich shall become the poor. All the fat cats, they run out. Banks have closed the doors since the big house come down. Since the big house come down. There's not a bloody soul around in the fattest in the town since the big house come down.
No, it's the big house. It's a sunny big house with lots of glass as we look outside onto a beautiful Melbourne day. Bill Kusznirczuk, good morning to you.
Oh, Darren, I'm in heaven.
Oh, I knew you would be.
It's magnificent.
I knew. Beautiful day. Christian Cole is a cabinet and furniture maker. He's the owner of Christian Cole Furniture. And we've spoken to Christian before. He's a unique individual because he loves recycling and he's a bit like myself. He loves the feel, the texture, and he has a passion for wood. Christian, good to see you again.
Hey, Darren, how are you?
Yeah, you're very innovative in your design of things, and you will see an old bit of wood. You could make something nice out of an old apple crate.
I reckon I could.
That's what you do, isn't it? You probably have.
That's exactly what we do.
That's what you do.
Huge skill. This is a huge skill, yeah. And we shouldn't underestimate it to be able to do that, particularly using recycled material. So you're using something that's previously been used and you're tailoring it, you're crafting it to be something special again.
That's exactly right. We've actually got a new apprentice at the moment. He was a bit flustered the other day, and I said to him, listen, this is not that easy to learn. There's a lot you've got to know about working the piece of timber, flattening it, straightening it, joining it with different glues for different species.
Oh, hang on a minute. Different glues for different species.
Yeah.
I use PVA, indoor-outdoor.
PVA's okay. We probably sort of head more cross-linking PVA for our laminating, which sort of bonds the timber a lot better too, keys it in. But we use a lot of these polyurethane foamout glues now too that are very structural and strong too. So
where do you get your glue from?
Germany.
More
German
so
glues.
There's a whole new science world in the world
glue's
of glue.
Glue's very important. If we give a 25-year warranty on all our workmanship, so the glue's got to last the jeopardy of the
That's
piece.
That's huge, 25 years. Christian, the toughest timber you've worked with, and then new trends. We're seeing a lot of bonded timber now being used for bench tops and that very hardy, very versatile.
Yep.
What do you got?
Look, we probably use 30 to 40 different species of timber, ranging from recycled to salvaged timbers off farm properties. We also use our FSC certified American timbers as well, depending on what the client wants in their house, because we try not to stain. We try and keep the natural beauty of the timber. And if you put a nice, good, solid, clear coat finish on it, it doesn't show the scratches as well either.
Now, we were talking to Darren a couple of weeks ago, and he was saying, listen, I'm keen to do my renovation at home, and I want to do this, I want to do that. But one thing he has been red hot, solid on, is he wants to make sure that he's got timber in his kitchen.
Oh, yeah, that's it. You can't beat it. And I think a lot of places these days, you know, you see on the TV shows and that, a lot of rooms need a little bit of timber to give it some warmth. It's a lot of rooms where people are doing it's too cold. It's too grey tiles, white walls. You need a bit of timber there. See, a lot of our tables look the best in people's homes that have got the clean room, and then they've just got this beautiful piece of organic timber sitting there. It's been finished nice.
Hey, did we speak to you since or before the block last year?
You spoke to me after the block last year.
Yeah, and because you now feature what the judges said about your work on the block.
Yeah, we did some. It was 2 years ago. It was for Jared and Maddie on level four, and we did some beautiful pieces in there out of American white ash too.
And what did the judges say?
Oh, they loved it. Yeah, they thought it was fantastic.
Did they say it had a wow factor?
Yeah, it had a connection. They said.
It had a connection?
Yeah, it had a connection.
With what?
Well, people come into the room and they have a connection with the piece, you know.
Right.
You know, so it looks
connection
good.
Connection to Mars? I don't know.
That's right.
Oh, it's got wow factor. It's got a connection.
Yeah, that's right.
But they're punsy, those judges.
you've got to do all that sort of stuff. But
fellows.
But a lot of the tables we do also for clients, you know, when you deliver a handmade piece of furniture that's hand-finished, hand-sanded, and being sanded up to, you know, 180 grit right through to 300 grit, we spend time filling it with all the clear epoxies. And when you look at the piece of timber, you don't need to do much to it.
It talks to you.
It does its own thing. So I bought some beautiful amber wood yesterday, slabs. I got some beautiful, see, it's all reclaimed. That was out of Croydon High School. So
you're kidding?
Yeah.
How did you source that? How did you know that Croydon High School had some good timber all of a sudden?
I've got this woodcutter who's a pretty rough-looking bloke with a few tats on him that rocks up a lot, and he says, you'll love this. And
right.
You know what he does to me? He does it on purpose. He brings extra slabs on his truck. Yeah. He's got no intention about selling them to me. But when I see them, I go, what's that? Where's that come from?
Yeah.
He'll tell me the story about it all, and I go, oh, I've got to have that.
And so you take it off his hands.
Because I don't get excited unless I keep using new timbers all the time. Because I see so much timber every day.
Yes.
I can almost look at it and go, oh, it's another big slab of recum that I'm working on today. But if I get different species all the time, I'm like, oh, look at this. This is interesting. So it's good.
And do you give him a slab for his slab?
Yeah, sometimes I'll give him a couple of slabs for a slab.
Because in the building industry, that's the international currency of the building industry.
Yep, isn't it? It is. Everything's slabs.
Yeah.
Yep.
How many? Four slab job, two slab job.
Yeah. And sometimes they don't want the nice fancy beer. They want the strong flavoured one.
Yes.
You know.
I loved it. The building industry, when the GST came in, they thought, we don't need that. We've got our own currency. It's known as the slab.
That's right. Exactly. But, some of that timber I got off the truck the other day was gorgeous. I'm dying to...
Well, what about how you seal a kitchen benchtop? Because I would have thought that's most probably critical. If you're going to be able to use it as a benchtop, it's got the versatility, it's hard wearing, so it's all of those things. But people would worry about how you're sealing it, particularly around wet areas and stuff like that. Possible?
Yeah, that's what, and a lot of people don't understand. When I get timber benchtop orders, I go out and measure up. I tell them to bring their sinks or their hot plates, any of their cutouts have to come to work. I cut everything out as we're sanding it. We do the cutout, we do the router out if they're undersung sinks. And we spend a lot of time sealing all those areas.
Yep.
Even if we're out on site and we're buzzing to your walls, subscribe to your walls, if they've got a bow in them or a hoof in them, we'll actually have clear coat products out there that will seal that sections. So once we do the cutout, we'll seal the sink section, we'll turn the bench top over and do four coats underneath, the same amount of coats that we're going to do on top. We'll then do an extra two coats on all the areas where wet areas will be as well in the seal part. So
it's a whole waterproofing membrane around it.
Timber's dried to 10 to 12% for your humidity in the house. But if you don't wrap it up and seal it up, it's going to grab water or it's going to grab moisture out of there and it's going to want to move around too much. So.
Yeah, 96900693. If you're familiar with Christian Cole's work, give us a call. Or if you have any questions about unusual slabs of timber that have been crafted into magnificent pieces of furniture, give us a call on that number. On 3AW, it's 18 past 10.
The Big House.
For E&S Trading, massive renovators sale on now. And the X Factor, 70s, 80s, 90s and noughties. Tomorrow, 6:30 on 7.
I'm your hand.
The Big House. Christian Cole is with us, cabinet and furniture maker extraordinaire, owner and founder of Christian Cole Furniture, and also Project Bus. I love guys and girls that get amongst a project and decide, yep, that's what I'm going to do. Just remind me of your project again with your bus.
The bus started about 6 months ago, and I've done all the French oak flooring, the French oak ceiling, and I'm just doing all the copper on the curves.
What sort of bus was it, Christian?
1987 Hino.
Yeah.
Full-size bus.
Yeah, 40-foot coach, it is.
And your electrician is sitting next to us, and his name is Greg Murphy. Greg, good morning to you.
Good morning, Darren. Good morning, Bill.
You're old friends.
Yeah, old mates from way back.
And you're the electrician on the bus.
I'm the bus electrician. I've been dragged in. So,
Is the bus any good?
Look, the final product would be fantastic. Christian's is a great craftsman, and with the copper detailing, it'll look fantastic.
Now let's not underestimate your ability, Greg. You're a project manager as a Sparky. Sparkies are very highly qualified people.
We are.
And how long have you been working for as a registered electrician?
Over 20 years now. Yeah. I actually did my apprenticeship with TAA as an aircraft electrician.
Which as opposed to a lamey.
Yeah, well,
you got Darren's attention.
Yeah,
aircraft.
Yeah. And so then I transferred across and did my electrical apprenticeship. And mainly in the domestic area. So I've had long experience in that and then moved on. And now I'm working for a company in Abbotsford. LJ Services, and they're a air conditioning and building management systems.
And I know why you've chosen that job, because it's in Abbotsford near Victoria Park.
Absolutely.
I get this vibe. I never ask our guests who they follow in the footy, but I just got this vibe. I said, who do you follow? And sure enough, bingo, Collingwood.
That's it. One-eyed. I've still got all my teeth, but...
I actually haven't. That one's false. Are you near Victoria Park?
We're just off Alexander Parade on the other side. Near Wellington Street.
Good stuff. So what have you had to do in the bus?
At the moment, we've just been talking about...
We've been talking about over beers.
We have.
So far, for a while.
So no work's actually been done.
Oh, look, we've done lots of stories. And
lots of drawings.
Lots of drawings.
Yeah.
And we're looking at, you know, how we're actually going to power up the bus, what sort of safety features we're going to put in there. So the same as a house, I have to put in safety switches. And now we're just got some lights, we're putting in some LED lighting is the way to go. It's safe, it's used low power.
So we've got the generator, we've got the generator too that we've got to work into it all.
So this is going to be for show.
I'm glad I've got Greg on board because I can do all the timber work, but all that sort of stuff, I'll get a bit dizzy with inverters and you've got generators. I want to be able to drive it along and have the generator running and have it exhausted.
So you're taking it on trips?
Yep.
To be self-sufficient so that it runs itself when you stop.
Yeah, and if I'm in a little bit of trouble at home, Darren, you know, I can just sort of, you know, we can just go for a journey. If you ever get into trouble too, you can just hop in and I'll pick you up and we'll go for a bit of a trip.
Yeah. Sounds good. So now we've got Greg the electrician that's here as well. So any questions on fine timber furniture and electrical questions? Barry joins us. Good morning.
Yes, good morning. We've got solid rig kitchen benches. The edges are undressed and it's both sides of the benches are undressed and it's solid red gum. I've had it for about 15 years now and I don't know whether you've got a photo of it there, but it's really outstanding benches.
Have you emailed it to me?
No, there was a photo on the internet. We just sold the house.
Oh, okay, beautiful. Yeah. So it's got the natural edges where the bark is.
Natural edges, and we went and to a place to pick out all the timber.
Yep.
So where the sink is, it's got a bit of a curve on the branch itself.
Yep.
So that you can sit in there and it's easy to get to your benches.
Oh, it sounds fantastic.
Selecting all the...
So you haven't had any drama. It's obviously been done right because you've had it for a long time and it's still looking good?
Oh, it's looking fantastic, yeah. It hasn't even been re-varnished.
Good. Beautiful.
Looks strong and doesn't have any marks on it. It's very, very hard timber, as you realise yourself.
That's an interesting one, Christian. How do you keep it clean? I mean, do you wipe it... Do you just wipe it with a microfiber cloth, the sort of damp hot water?
The worst thing you can do to timber is leave water sitting on it for over 24 hours. It'll eventually... It could be okay, but if you've got a little bit of a hairline crack in the timber, it could get in there.
But once you've done your stuff and you've created the product, it's not high maintenance, is it?
No. And you've got to, with kitchen bench tops especially, we'll probably do up to 6 to 7 coats on it. I mean, you've almost got to choke... Sometimes by choking the grain, I mean you're closing the grain over and you're fully sealing it really well. And it's all got to do with, I mean, the timber can be really hard, but it's all got to do with the product that's on the timber. Because the product has to have stretch in it as well for the timber to be able to move. See, polyurethanes are too brittle and they'll crack.
Yeah.
If the timber wants to move, so you've got to have a product that'll move with it as well. So
move with the times. Thanks, Barry, for the call. I was watching a special and it was set in, was it Iceland? Anyway, they had a scientific outpost and they drill down into the ice and they find out the history of the Earth because it's been frozen and all the leaves. This is a long story to get around to a work question. So anyway, during the summer, when the summer ends, the Hercules comes and lands on the ice and they pack up their station. And their station is sort of like this underground sort of ice cave, and there's a little building on the top. Now, to seal off the building, they just use plywood, like it would have been a big sheet of marine ply to block off the entrance. Why is plywood so tough?
Oh, I don't know. I suppose it's laminating the glues they use. It depends on what... They're probably using, obviously, a waterproof marine ply. So, it ply's good. Look, I use ply all through our kitchens. We don't use any MDF or melamine.
Don't you?
No. And we... It's nicer for the boys to work with at work because it hasn't got a lot of those toxic chemicals in it.
Yeah, yeah.
So we try and it's eco-friendly for the home as well. So MDF's bad news.
Well, I tell you what, it's funny you should say that. I bought a sheet of ply for a bench top in my garage because the old one was MDF and it had got water on it.
Yeah,
thank you.
No
and
good.
If you get a drop of water on MDF, she swells an old footballer's knee.
Why on earth would people use MDF as skirtings and architraves in their house? I mean, you get water with a mop or you spill a bucket and it gets underneath because they're not sealing it under. underneath.
No.
When they paint it, half of them.
Exactly. Yeah. So the ply, I made this bench top out of, and I bought it from Bunnings for about $8.
Yep. Yep.
It's not expensive, is it?
And see, I use a birch grey ply, which is a select grade ply. So what I'll do in all the drawers and in all the cupboards of the kitchen, we'll seal it with the two-pack as well.
Yeah.
And it looks beautiful as you open it up. It looks nice.
Yeah, exactly.
It's stronger. It looks better, and it's not
more
that much...
More water durable.
Yep, and it's not that much more cost of... Like, the cost might be $1,000 in a $25,000 kitchen.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? The scheme of things, why would you not do
exactly.
it?
Exactly.
Yeah.
An email has arrived for you. Christian, he says, Christian, on the Western Highway past Beaufort at Middle Creek, there's timber galore from the trees cut for the highway duplication. A woodworker's woody paradise, he describes it as.
Oh, geez, that sounds good.
You might have to get up there.
Yeah.
John joins us. Good morning.
Good morning, gentlemen.
John,
look, am I coming through loud and clear?
Loud and clear, over.
Okay, Roger.
Roger.
A lot of people and myself were thinking about investing money in these solar panels, but they worry me, speaking to electricians, and I mean, is this going to turn out to be another white elephant in the future? I mean, as the surface wears on these panels, they lose their effectiveness. Hailstorm, how badly does hailstorm damage affect the panels? And power companies, I really don't trust them. I know I sound negative, but I'm trying to be a realist. Now, let's not confuse...
Something positive to say in the world?
let's not confuse negativity with being a realist. Now, the power companies, I don't trust them. I mean,
just hang on for one sec. Just on those issues, it's interesting because, you see, it doesn't matter whether you're talking about timber bench tops or solar panels. All of those things require someone smart to put them together, someone to be able to craft them properly, someone to be able to install them properly, and then someone thereafter to be able to maintain them properly. So whether you're talking about the solar panels, whether you're talking about Christian's timber work, whether you're talking about Greg's electrical work, they're the basic ingredients. And if you get the right people, if you get reputable people, if you're dealing with those sort of people that are qualified and registered in their field, you're going to be on top. So it doesn't matter what you're talking about, solar panels or anything else. That's my view anyway.
Yep.
What do you reckon, boys?
What do you reckon, Greg?
Look, I think solar panels are a very good thing for everyone in different situations, but you have to try and see if they're right for you. I know the government is making changes, but it all comes down to your decision, whether or not you can afford them, whether or not you want to feel that you're contributing back into the power grid. So I think they're a really good thing for a sustainable energy type situation.
I reckon they're fantastic too. I'm actually thinking about putting them on the factory.
And the bus.
And I've worked out the payments of the solar versus my power bill, which is $2,000 a quarter.
Yeah.
I was going to be $50 better off with the solar on the roof. And it's a 25-year warranty on the panels. And he said to me that most of them will last up to 40 years.
So only $50 better off, did you say?
Yeah, $50 better off in the repayments of the money that I was going to lease to do it, to do the job.
So right.
It was going to cost me $300 a quarter in power versus $2,000.
Yeah, but you'd chew through power.
Oh, I do.
Your machinery, your equipment, you'd be...
And I've got a factory that's quite eco-friendly. I've got water tanks, I've got the chickens, I've got the garden veggies.
Hang on, chickens in a factory?
Yeah, we've got the chickens out the front.
Where are they?
They're for all the apprentices to have their omelets, and I have a couple of omelets each morning.
Oh, I've got to come to your
factory. You've got to come out, Darren.
Yeah.
I can't believe you haven't come yet.
Have you got a garden? You should have a vegetable
garden. Yeah, I've got all the veggie gardens.
Oh, you have?
Yeah, from a disability agency, we get a couple of guys that come in 3 days a week and they work in all the veggie garden.
Oh,
so
good on
it's
you.
Good. Yeah.
And how many on staff now?
Five. Yeah,
right.
Five. Yeah, it is a very complicated industry to learn. There's a lot to learn.
Oh,
so
yeah.
The apprentice looked quite stressed the other day. I said, just relax.
Relax.
I said, just take in each section at a time.
Go learn and spend 5 minutes with the chickens and come back to me.
He had about 40 chair components in front of him and I had him sanding him and he thought, oh my God.
Oh really? how old was he?
He's 19. He's a lovely kid too. He's good.
He's
good. Yeah, he's really good.
Yep. What's his name?
Matt.
Where'd you get him from?
He came and approached me, actually. He goes to NMIT in Heidelberg. Yeah, but
does he love wood?
That's right. He come from Malamine doing doing a lot of, you know, MDF work and stuff like that. He wanted to work with the real deal, so...
Yeah, good on him.
It's come to the right place.
The board's open, 96900693. Hey, give us a call if you've got any electrical questions. We've got John here. Greg, I should say, Greg Murphy. And Christian Cole, cabinet and furniture maker extraordinaire at 26 to 11.
Live from Mercedes-Benz Melbourne at 135 Kingsway, South Melbourne. The Big House on 3AW 693.
Kate joins us. Good morning.
Yeah, good morning, guys. Christian, this question's for you. I've got a bamboo bench top, which is about 12 months in, and the guy that did the kitchen wanted to use polyurethane or whatever you call it, sealer, and I said, no, we put tung oil on it. What is the best sealer for a bamboo bench top?
If you're going to do it by hand, you're probably better off doing your tung oil finish. You're just going to have to put coats on via rag and not take it off.
Yeah, that's what we did. Is that the best way? Is that I did a bit of research?
Yeah, but... you can use a single base polyurethane that you can get from, you know, Cabot's or Bunnings or places like that. You've just got to be careful using that because it's got polyurethane in it. Just make sure you wear a mask. It's not good stuff.
I didn't want to use that.
Look, I'd use tung oil. You just got to make sure you put... I think people that use oil don't put enough of the product on. Oil has got hardeners in it for it to go off, but you need to put a fair bit on to make sure it's durable and it's going to seal the timber up.
Okay, well, thanks for that. Just also in closing, I work for a very reputable solar company, and what that gentleman says is quite right. The secret is to get a good installer and a good product, works well.
Aha. There's the key. It's like anything, quality.
Yep, it's the usual thing, isn't it? People, if you cut corners and you don't, you know, sometimes you have to spend a little bit extra to get it done properly.
Yep.
Kate, would you like to head up to the Dandenong Ranges and just sit in the Cuckoo restaurant and eat?
I'd love to do that.
Yes. Well, I'm going to let you. I mean, I'm going to make you. No, what am I doing? I'm giving you a double pass to the Cuckoo.
Dinner
for two.
Wow, okay, that's lovely. I appreciate that. I've never run... one time I spoke to Darren Hinch many years ago, but thank you.
It's what magnificent Bavarian food there. You will love it.
Yeah, good
a
on
bit
you.
Of Venus schnitzel, oh. Bit of sauerkraut,
bit of Lederhosen,
mushroom sauce, a bit, beer.
Bit of yah, yah.
Doesn't get better.
Hold the line, Kate. We'll get your details. Jason joins us. Good morning.
Good morning. How are you, boys?
Good, thanks.
Morning.
That's good. Just a quick question. I've purchased a big slab of silky oak, and it's quite pory. You know, you can see into the timber with little pores. Would I be best to use a sanding sealer or just fill it, like the previous caller said, with a tung oil?
You mean pores, like the grain's quite open on it?
Yeah, it is. Yeah, it looks like the pores of your skin. You can sort of see into it a little bit.
Yeah, righto. Well, sometimes you don't want to close that completely over because people need to touch and feel the real deal. So...
Yeah, okay.
Do you know what I mean? You need to still just do the same as what you'd normally do. So do probably three or four coats. Rub them back with 400 grit in between your coats. But see, when I do a lot of finishes on our tables, I try and make sure I still see the grain. If you put too much on, it looks too plasticky. So you need to use a fine line there.
Yeah.
You're actually lucky that you've got a piece of timber like silky oak that's got that grain. It's easier to put a few more coats on without it choking up too much, if that makes any sense.
Yeah, because I didn't want it to look like a urethane finish. I prefer the matte.
Yeah, that's what we're doing at the moment. See, we spray 2-pack, but it's a lacquer 2-pack from Sweden. And it's...
Yes.
We do fine coats, but what we use is it's a 0% gloss. So it actually just looks like a wet look. Because you don't want that glossy. It looks too plasticky.
Yeah, it does.
Definitely.
Yeah.
No, the timber's... Yeah, it's going to be a vanity top.
Oh, it'd be beautiful, mate. That's all you need sometimes. Just one nice top like that on some... you know, flat painted cupboards, and it just gives it that lift.
Where'd you source it from, Jason?
That one came from the woodworking show last year
we were talking about that at the
convention center.
Showgrounds.
Yeah, good on you. You'll love doing that. That's great.
No. All right, thanks very much.
Good on you, Jason. Silky oak from the tree Grevillea robusta.
You're better than me. With
Jane
that.
Taught me that.
Big oak.
You're better than me.
AKA big
words.
Oak.
Yeah, big mother.
Big mother.
No calls for you, Greg, so far. How do you feel?
A bit quiet tonight.
Yeah. A bit left out.
A bit left out. I'll tell you what, we only have to mention smart meters and...
there you go. You've got the balls lined up now.
You're smart meters.
You won't be doing any work on a bus, no. That's for sure.
They've worked out well, haven't they?
They have, but... look, I think they've ironed out most of their problems now, and people are still complaining a bit about them.
I sleep with my head about a foot from one. I'm not happy about that.
No.
Because they radiate a signal far and beyond.
I wouldn't be happy.
I think most of them, look, they all meet pretty stringent requirements. So,
yeah.
And they,
doesn't matter how hard you try.
People used to think smoking was good too.
Yeah, it's gonna come back. don't worry.
But the evolution of the LED, and we've spoken about this quite a bit on the program, retrofitting or buying whole new units. What are your thoughts for a downlight this is?
Look, there's some really great products out at the moment that have for retrofitting into your existing downlights, and yeah, that's the way to go. In saying that, if you're doing a renovation, such as yourself, certainly have a look at the LEDs. You can get these strip LEDs now, which create really good mood lighting, soft up lighting, and also you can get your standard downlights, but in LED, which are great.
Yeah.
And they've come down in price big time in the last 18 months.
I put in some LED, and they're blue, and they're decking lights, and I put them around the skirting board in the garage.
Yep.
So they look like runway lights.
Nice.
It's great.
And I've that got, gives you a bit of ambient light, wouldn't it?
Would it's great. Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, yeah, good idea.
And it's 0.3 of a watt.
Yeah, nothing.
Per light.
Yeah.
So I run it off a domestic little, what do you call it, transformer.
Yep.
And it's pulling what? There's six of them.
16 watts.
Six times point three. Sorry, six times point three.
He's Collingwood, don't forget. Don't build him up.
Six times point three and it's bugger all.
Yeah. 1.8 watts.
Pat, good morning.
How are you going?
Yeah, good, Pat.
That's good. I thought up a wooden question, seeing that you didn't have any calls. I'm just mopping my beautiful gum floor, which went down in my apartment last year. And this time I had it just done with a satin finish, which looked beautiful. But I don't think it's sort of weathering too well, and nobody ever told me how I should wash and clean it. I have been mopping it with cold water. Today I thought, no, I'll do it with hot water, and I think that leaves less water sitting on the surface.
You probably need to find out what the product is before you sort of find out what you're going to put on it. So
it's gum. And what's that special gum floor that everyone raves about?
No, not the timber, the actual product, so the finish. So whether you've got a two-pack finish on it, or is it a tungal finish, natural gum, what sort of finish is on the floor?
It's a low satin finish.
Right. So, you look, there's cleaning products that you can use that are made for timber. The best way to do it, you've got to just try them out and see how they go on it.
But we've got hardwood floors at home, and and we just use a combo of water with methylated spirits, a mix, and then we just run it, microfiber brooms, just run it across there. And
take a try bit of metho, that's what my wife does, in a bucket of hot water.
Metho?
Yeah.
Right.
Just a little bit, yeah.
Yep. Good on you, Pat. On 3AW, it's 10:45. Morning.
Good morning, gentlemen. You gave a bit of advice about using metho on the floor.
Yeah.
Most cases, that's good, but if your floor's epoxy or two-pack base, but a lot of these new eco-based systems and eco-based paints, they're all acrylic-type style. And if you go put metho on it, you're actually going to bring up or destroy the coating you've got.
You're spot on. This stuff is French oak, two-pack, and the metho works just fine, Sam. Bit of hot water, microfiber cloth. It comes up sparkling, the best timber I've ever, ever seen on a floor.
French oak, that's what I used on the bus, on the ceiling, on the
sensational.
Floor.
Sensational. Yep. Yeah, you're right, Sam. Thanks a lot.
Where did you get your French oak from?
Out of the wine vats from Mildura.
Oh, you go everywhere, don't you?
Yeah, so that come out of the crushing vat. So when you go on the bus, I don't want to seal it, because you go in there and it's like this big red wine smell. You know?
Oh,
it's
really?
It's amazing.
Fantastic.
Yeah. It's beautiful.
Well, the smell stays in there.
Oh, yeah, it just stays in there. Because I think once I've... See, I actually split the boards in half and booked them through the floor.
Yeah.
So I opened them up. And once you open them up, all the red wine, you can see where it's been through. It's beautiful.
How are you cutting it? How are you cutting some of this stuff? I mean, there must be new technology with cutting
equipment. I've just spent $50,000 on a new panel saw. So that's coming from Germany next month. But you've got to have the right blade. It's all got to do with having sharp blades. And we've got bandsaws. We cut our own veneers as well. So they're more, instead of being 1 mil thick, they're about 3 or 4 mil thick, which has got that barrier there. So we do a lot of compound mitre in veneers as well. So
I'll tell you what, it's not forgiving either. Timber, if you're not cutting it properly, you break it, you crack it, you snap it.
It can be a nightmare to work with sometimes. You can do everything by the book and you go, why are you doing this now?
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So it's just one of those things you learn. That's probably the biggest thing you do learn over the years of working with it, of its behaviour and how to use it and flipping your hearts and using quarter sawn versus back sawn.
Well, how did you kick off? What was the interest?
I made my mum some stools of ball and high at lunchtimes. And then I...
Detention.
Yeah.
Detention.
Yep. And she loved them. And then I got off an apprenticeship. I did work experience for an old fellow in Hawthorne making Baltic pine and Cowrie pine dresses.
Yeah.
And then I just sort of thought, this is what I want to do. I didn't want to be at school, so I thought I might as well go now and get it over and done and start doing the apprenticeship now.
Good on you. Mate of mine that I play squash with, Mike Dalgleish, he left Melbourne for a while to run a timber mill up in the bush.
Yep.
And you're saying timber not being forgiving, he was running a big strip through whatever saw it was, and it recoiled, and he looked down, and this bit that was 2x2 had splintered off as a spear and went straight through his bicep and out the other side.
You've got to be careful.
With his left hand, he ripped it out, and he just lost it.
Yeah.
He's okay, and they've redone the nerves and stuff, and for rehabilitation, he's back to normal. But gee whiz, he said it's unbelievable what happened.
You've got to be very careful.
Yeah. It's 5 to 11.
The Big House. For E&S Trading, massive renovators sale on now. And the X Factor, 70s, 80s, 90s and noughties. Tomorrow, 6:30 on 7.
Amber, I've got about 30 seconds for you. Good morning.
Good morning. How are you going?
Yeah, good.
I just rang to say that Christian Cole Furniture has just finished installing an American ash kitchen in our house, and it's the absolute focal point of our house, and it's majestical.
Out of 10?
If you could do 100 out of 10, you would. The finish is natural, it's beautiful, and everyone that comes in just comments on how beautiful this kitchen is.
You're off to the Tesla Tulip Festival. Hold the line, we'll get your details. What a great note to finish off on, Christian. Thanks for coming in.
Yeah, thanks very much for that.
And to you, Greg Murphy, electrician, lovely to meet you too.
Thank you.
Thanks for having us.
Pleasure. We're staying here for the Streetwise program. That's next on a beautiful day in Melbourne. Stick around.